Yes. Well, we recognize that we cannot continue the night soil bucket system. From the environmental public health point of view, it will be a disaster. Mm. You're building housing board flats, they are all very compact. You'll be a very compact, densely populated city. And therefore, night soil inside the house is just impossible for us from the environmental public health point of view. Therefore, it is simply an imperative that we should get rid of it and lay sewers to every home in Singapore. The whole idea is the human waste, when it is produced, must be removed from the house, from the home, as soon as it possibly can for the highest standard of environmental public health. So we embark upon a massive program starting from the 1960s to lay sewers throughout the whole of Singapore so that every home will have a sewer and modern sanitation installed. Mm-hmm. And we succeeded in the late 1980s when the last night soil bucket came back to us. Well, it's a very long story, but perhaps I can tell you what are the critical factors that are needed. Mm-hmm. First, there must be political stability. In other words, you cannot have changes of government or from one political party to another every 5 years. It's impossible. Secondly, water policy must be consistent. Right down when we plan our water master plan, we got to think not in terms of 5 years, but we got to think in terms of 30, 40, 50. In Singapore, we plan up to 50, 100 years. Mm-hmm. And therefore, there must be political stability. There must be policy consistency. Without these two, I don't think any water plan will ever succeed. You cannot keep changing, the investors won't come, or you cannot build up your infrastructure if priorities keep changing and so on. So these are the two extremely important ones. Of course, the third one is equally important. You need to have an institution that is built on technology, and PUB is such an institution today. You need to keep track of the latest technologies that are available so that you can bring them into Singapore and put them into practice here. So all these three factors must be brought in before any water master plan in any country can succeed. Mm-hmm. That's why when other countries come to visit us to see what are the technologies that we have that they can bring home, we always feel that they are not really looking at the right things. The right things really would have to be, they got to sort out the politics of the country, or if that can ever be done. There must be stable political climate in the country. Mm-hmm. Secondly, there must be consistency of policy. These are the two fundamentals. So, overall, that's what we need to have before we can launch out onto a water master plan. Mm-hmm. So we're very fortunate that we do have this for the last 20, 30 years. And it accounts so much for the success that we have today. Of course, beyond that, you need a water master plan, the water policy, then the individual projects and so on. Many countries think in terms of projects because, you know, short term, you want to cut the ribbon, you know, you want to show the plan that we have built. But we do it the other way around in Singapore. We have a long-term plan and the parcel of the projects, and then we come up with the projects. So the cutting of the ribbon is all the way downstream, you know. And that accounts for the success that we have. We have always made it clear to those who visit us that no water management program can ever succeed if it stands alone. It has to go hand in hand with social, economic progress of the entire country, you know. The population needs to be informed, and they need to assimilate it, that water conservation has to be a way of life. They are not socially responsible, that will never sink in with them, you know. Mm-hmm. They got to know that they must not pollute the water courses because, you know, you can't have dirty rivers. And therefore, public education must go up. Social responsibility must go up. Mm. The recognition of law and order in the country must be there. Otherwise, how to enforce the laws, you know. Corruption must not be present at all. Otherwise, you know, people can pay themselves away, you know, from all these things. So the whole country, economic as well as social, must progress that way. Mm-hmm. The people must be prepared to pay for the water that has been treated for them to use. They cannot think of it as free. For them to be able to pay for the water, there must be jobs for them, you know. you must have the financial capacity to build the plants, collect the money, mm-hmm. and so on. So economic progress must come in also. So no water program in any country can succeed by itself. It has to go with the national development, social, economic, educational, law and order, all these things must come in. So that is the second order of things. First, political stability. Secondly, consistency of policy. Second order of things, the whole nation must progress. Economic, social, law and order, and all this, education and so on.
Thank you.
Yes. Yeah, when I think about pig farms, it brings me all the way back to our early days, the history of it. Pigs are very pollutive animals. One pig will produce 5 times the waste that a human being does. And it is in high concentration. In those days, we have the primary production department and they were promoting pig farms, you know, and they were all over Singapore.
Mm-hmm.
We wanted the water. The pig farmers have got no means of treating the pig waste. Every morning they use our water, fresh PUB water, they flush the pigsty, and all the pig waste goes into the drain, straight into the rivers, and we're going to put up dams at the end of the rivers, at the river mouth, to create new reservoirs.